says they went off to Canary Wharf. This is a sort of dramatic finale of the story. Now, at 10:30 that morning, media outlets around the world, with the exception of Britain, reported two young men gunned down as terrorists at Canary Wharf. Okay. Then there was another report of a single person being gunned down at Canary Wharf by the HSBC bank before 11 o'clock. Then at 11 o'clock, as it were, once the young men had been got rid of, then the story of bombers was launched. If you remember, all up to then it was power surges. And it was like, oh, we had a power surge on the tube. And everyone was talking about power surges in the media. And only at 11 o'clock, this was to do with the bus going bang, when it suddenly lifted the roof off the bus here. So a very, very clean cut roof there. Suddenly lifted the bus off, and the story of bombs came out then at 11 o'clock for terrorists with bombs. And I suggest that could be because they wanted to wait till those young men had been taken out. Why were they got to Canary Wharf, you might wonder? If once they realised something terrible was going on, say about 10 to 9, huge crowds started milling out on King's Cross, and imagine they were separated from Hasib Hussein, he would have had his operating instructions would have been to hang around for an hour later. That bus wasn't scheduled to blow up for an hour later. So he was somehow separated off from the others. We don't know any more than that. Now, supposing the other two decided to bolt back to where they'd just come from. They didn't know London very well. Supposing they just decided to bolt back to Thameslink. Now, Thameslink, which is the railway that they got from Luton, is separate from the underground. It's important to appreciate that, about 5 or 10 minutes walk away. And that's one reason why the government times wouldn't fit once they tried to adjust all the times. They go back to Thameslink and jump on the same platform where they just come off from. Well, they don't have to think a great deal. If they're just petrified, you know, what do? Young men, well, they just bolt back to where they came from and just say there's a train there, they jump on it. Okay, that's going south towards Gatwick. Suppose they decide, well, hang on, we don't really want to end up at Gatwick, that would be crawling with security. They get off at Liverpool Street, and then it's just a few stops to Canary Wharf. So I think it would have been very easy for them to end up there. The London Underground, as a whole, was shut down about 20 past nine. That's when the order for big shutdown. So I think I personally think it's very credible that they could have ended up there. Then at 2 o'clock, the British police have a public meeting, and they're asked the question, what about reports of police shooting down two terrorists and terrorists at Canary Wharf? And the answer is, we have no reports of police shooting anyone at Canary Wharf that morning, or shooting any terrorists. And that, I suggest to you that is true. I suggest to you that it was not the police that shot them down, just as the gunning down of de Menezes 2 weeks later was not the British police. Metropolitan Police do not gun down people with point blank range of 7 bullets and held to the floor of a train. That wasn't the Metropolitan Police. But the Metropolitan Police were not at liberty to deny it. That's the interesting thing. The Metropolitan Police would really have loved to say, look everybody, we really, really don't do that sort of thing. You know, we don't shoot innocent citizens like that. But they were not allowed to. The amazing thing, the people who did this had total security protection. And I suggest to you that it's the FRR, Force Reconnaissance Regiment, or something like them that did it. This is a branch a bit like the SAS. They were just established a couple of months before July 7th, and they had bomb-making skills from Northern Ireland. They were above the law, they had a licence to kill, they had a total security clearance, and these are very likely to be people involved in the perpetration of the July 7th event. It's quite feasible and conceivable that these are the people who shot the terrorists, the young men at Canary Wharf and at Menezes. And let's just note, in terms of media coverage, there's very little that's said about them, They then turn up at Basra the next year. Basra. And they're disguised as Arabs, Zafara, and they've got some bombs in a car, so they're planning to look like Arabs planting bombs. They're arrested, and then they have to, once they're in jail, they have to be totally rescued by the British SAS. And you can't even be told their names. I mean, you're not even told their names. They have to be rescued. They cannot be interrogated, because there's something they knew that they just must not be interrogated. And when that story breaks, knowledgeable newspapers like, say, the Scotsman, for example, had obviously well-informed sources talk about the FRR being involved with Timonese's assassination I don't know if they didn't mention the Canary Wharf, but I think that's likely as well. And then after that, we never really hear anything more of the FRR. So it's rather doubtful. I suppose anti-terror branch, the British establishment. Can we go around and show the mascot? Can you see?
Yeah, we can go
ahead. Anyway, it's a picture of a sword going up to. Is it on the camera? Okay, so I'm suggesting that, that we should accept the ripple effect story. Those young men, that's what they do, that's where they end up. It's a bit of a mystery what happens to Hasip Hussein, but I suggest the evidence is that they're not on the bus and the trains that they're meant to be. Okay? Right, I'd like to move on now to inquest evidence of what happened on the bus and the train, which has been, I think, quite a revelation and much ignored by the British press. Well, anyway, there's a scary logo of the FRR with a sword, with a Roman-type helmet and a sword shoved up through it.
Yeah, it's buried in your stick there.
Okay. Let me just say, well, I think conclusive proof of the innocence of these four, if there's no murder weapon, then there isn't a case. If you want to prove someone's guilty of murder, you have to have a murder weapon, okay? Now, the murder weapon in this case is some sort of bomb. They've got to have something that goes bang, okay? You've got to believe that they came down with those rucksacks, quite apart from where the three young men can detonate synchronously within 50 seconds. We've got no discernible objection to British way of life, or no discernible, very little of discernible political views. I mean, Khan would get furious about the Iraq war, but that doesn't make him a terrorist, okay? So, did these people have any interest or knowledge about chemistry? Well, obviously not. And attempts are made that when they went over to Pakistan, told secrets of bomb making, how to make a bomb and so on. Well, let's just look at the ever-changing story. Within days after July 7th, real forensic experts were there sniffing around the remains, and they said this is military-grade explosive, C4, and detonators. So the synchronous bomb story came out with detonators, which is possibly TATP or something like that, and as military-grade explosive, which gives blast with very little heat or light. There's pure blast. And that's what they think really did it. And we're talking about something that can lift up a rail coach off the rails and blow it apart, rip it apart like a can of sardines. Both the floor and the ceiling are ripped apart. It's pretty powerful stuff, whatever it was, okay? Now, within a week, that suffered a laughable metamorphosis into something called TATP because the story had to be suicide bombers up in Leeds. So the train went up to Leeds, and where did they, a bath, fancy that, a bomb-making factory, a bath, right. And a whole lot of 20 pounds of TATP left in the bath. Oh, right. So the police arrive on the 12th of July, that they barge into what they're alleging is a bomb-making factory, which happens to be a room rented by Magdi Al-Nashar, who's a PhD graduate at Leeds University, and he knew Lindsay, right? And he just flies off on the 5th to Cairo.